Hello world, welcome back to this new video. Today I would like to make a video which is a bit special, and it's about how to solder your Zeal 8-bit computer kit. So to start, you will need a soldering iron, of course. You will need a bit of solder. So this is leaded solder, this is a 60-40 solder. A pair of tweezers, it can be very helpful. So you can also have this kind of glove if you're afraid of burning yourself. And of course, you will need the 8-bit computer kit. Let's open the box, which contains all the components for the 8-bit computer. In the box, you will find two tubes, one containing the ICs and another one containing the sockets. You will also find some bags containing the rest of the components. We will go through each of them during the video. In total, we have 14 items. Let's get started with the most important one, the PCB. On the bottom left of the PCB, you will find the version. The one that I am going to solder in this video is version 1.3.1. We start by soldering the resistors first. I highly advise you to bend the legs as shown in the video, so that you will be able to cut them later much more easily than if you bend them completely. So I'm going to do that for all the resistors. This table contains the values of each resistors. Then comes the diodes. So for the diodes, it will be a bit harder to bend the legs. They're not as soft as the resistors. There is a black line on it that should be put near the K on the PCB, the K marking. It can be tricky sometimes to insert the diode, so be very careful. Time to solder the resistors and the diodes. I put a bit of solder on the tip of my soldering iron first. Then I apply heat to each of the pins while I add some solder at the same time. The result looks great. It may happen that one of them is higher than the others. It's easy to fix. Simply apply heat on the legs while pushing on it from the other side. Then we are going to put the deep sockets. As you can see on the PCB, there is a small U, and on the sockets themselves, there is also a small notch. So of course you have to align the notch with the marking on the PCB. Let's put all the sockets. Afterwards, I flip the board. You can use any hard object. Here I'm using another PCB. And what I like to do is I like to solder only two pins out of the sockets, so the top right and the bottom left, just so that the sockets don't fall if I turn back the PCB. It also makes it easier to desolder the socket if they are too high and not inserted properly. I also check again if the position of the notch is correct before soldering all the other pins. And as you can see on the video, I forgot to put the deep 32 socket, so I'm going to add it right now. Okay, everything is ready, they're all in the right direction, so I can solder them all. Nice! Now we have to solder the two connectors on the top of the PCB. So in this packet you will find both the user port and the extension port. It's pretty straightforward, you just insert them, you flip the board, and here you can just start soldering them directly. Nice! Now come the PLCC sockets, so we have two PLCC 44 and one PLCC 32. Uh, So these sockets have a small circle at the top left, and it marks the direction. On the PCB, there will be a small notch on the top left. So align the sockets as shown in the video right now. Then, as usual, just flip the board and you can start soldering. Nice, they don't move, they're very solid, it's perfect, we can move on. So now there is no really any order for the remaining components, but what I like to do is start soldering the E-fuse socket. So it's the only SMD component on the board, so you should be very careful, it's not very hard. So the way I do is I put a bit of solder on the top pad, then I melt the solder I just put, and I slide the socket on top of it. So it's solid enough so that I can start soldering the other pad. And the goal will be to put some solder underneath. If you don't manage to do it at the first time, it's okay. You can add a bit of flux as I'm doing right now in the video, and it will let the solder flow much better. Remember, just take your time. And afterwards you can check whether you solder it properly thanks to a multimeter in continuity mode. After installing the fuse, I solder the LED. Be careful, the LED has a direction. After all, it's normal. They are just regular diodes. Then the USB-C port. So you have to be a bit careful with the USB-C port. The legs are quite short, so you will have to put some solder inside the PCB. Then comes the 6-pin power switch. So under the power switch, there is a small rectangle. Make sure this rectangle is at the bottom. We can perform our first test just to check whether there is any short on the board or if we soldered everything properly. So I like to add such USB tester, which will detect any short circuit or will prevent the board from actually frying. And perfect, the LED is on. We can continue, there is no short on the board. So I'm going to solder the PS2 connector. Nothing special for this one. It may be a bit hard to insert it at the beginning, but then you can just solder it. Like, nothing special to say about this board. I continue with the reset switch, which is the 4-pin one. Then this bag has quite a lot of components. So let's open it, and I'm going to solder the 3-pin jumpers. So you have to be very careful with those. It's a bit hard to solder them while keeping them straight. So what I do is I touch the plastic while I'm soldering the pin that is on the other side. I also solder the 2-pin jumpers. Then I continue with the battery holder. So there is a direction for this one, just follow the way I did on the video. There is also this internal connector, this 5-pin connector. The lock should be located on the right of the board. On top of the reset switch, there is this 3-pin footprint, which is the supervisor reset circuit. We can solder the oscillator, which is the main clock, the main 10 megahertz clock. This component also has a direction. One of the corners is not rounded, it has a right angle. It should be placed at the bottom left. On the PCB, the footprint shows the same shape, the bottom left corner is not rounded. So check the footprint on the PCB. Now come the resistor networks. So on the resistor itself, there is a small dot, and this small dot should be put at the top of the footprint. You will see that on the board, on the footprint, there is a small square which marks how this dot should be aligned with the PCB. So there are two 9-pins resistor networks, which are 1 kilo ohm, and a shorter one, which is 4.7 kilo ohm. Another tip here, you can just solder a single one. just to see whether it's straight or not, and if you're satisfied with it, just solder the rest of the pins. We continue with the crystal oscillator, the 32 kHz one, which is used by the RTC chip. So you insert it and you bend it. So now what we are going to do is take one of the legs from the resistor that we cut earlier, and what you want to do is put it on top of the crystal oscillator so that it pushes it on its pad. So what this will do is ground the case of the oscillator. Let's continue with the capacitors. So there are two rounded capacitors, which are 100 nanofarad. These are used for the keyboard logic decoding. So they go on the footprint marked C17 and C18. The rest of the capacitors go in all the other places marked as C on the footprint, which the reference is C. So we have C15, C16, C10, etc., etc. We can insert the video connector now. So if it doesn't fit properly, just bend a bit the legs. It may happen that sometimes the legs are not very straight. Again, I solder only two pins to check if it's positioned properly, and if that's the case, I solder the rest of the pins. And after that, we can proceed to the second quick test to see if there is no short and everything is working. And yes, the light goes on. The next step is to populate the chips. Populate the jumpers first, put the top one on the right and the bottom one on the left. This will enable the V-blank interrupts. If you don't have any video board, you can put both on the right. We can start populating with the chips. So we start with the Z80PIO, which is a PLCC44. It goes in the socket that is on the left. Then we have the Z80 CPU, it goes on the right, of course. At the bottom right in the PLCC32 socket, we have the NOR flash, which is the SST39. Now we continue with the RAM, which is the DIP32 chip. So this one can be a bit hard to insert, so you should really take your time here. You can bend its legs with thanks to a hard surface or a pin bender. Be very careful to not bend them too much and not break the legs. Each of the socket on the PCB is marked with the reference of the chip, so make sure to match them properly, and of course for each component make sure that the notch is at the top. Here I am installing the 74HC670 and the 74HC541. Together they make the MMU. Then comes the ATF16V8, which is the logic glue. It is responsible for generating the chip enable signals to almost all chips on the PCB. These two chips are the 595 shift registers used for the keyboard decoding logic. This is the 74 kilobytes I2C EEPROM. In the OS, it will be represented as disk B, so all the files created there would be saved in this chip. So we have the 74LS07, which goes here. That's pretty much it. This is what the board should look like after populating all the chips. Cool, right? Okay, final step. We connect the video board. Make sure that the jumpers are placed. We plug the VGA cable. I plug my PS2 keyboard. Let's plug the USB-C cable. I power on and... yep, it boots. Great. So you may see a message on screen that says that the EEPROM is not formatted, and it's quite normal, so we have to format it, and we can do this directly from the bootloader. This is what we are going to do. So we press escape on the keyboard to enter the menu from the bootloader. Then we press Q to format the EEPROM, and we choose the size. So here I have a 64 kilobyte one, so I just press 0. We can also do the self-test, hardware self-test, by pressing T. Then it asks us to press some keys on the keyboard. Yep, it works. And of course the RTC is disabled because I didn't put any battery in it. I press 1 to boot into the OS. I can CD to the EEPROM disk, which is empty of course. I can create a directory inside just to test it. And everything looks fine, and I can finally try to execute the snake game, which will use the graphics capabilities of the video board. And yes, it works too. Great. So this means that you perfectly soldered the board, it's working properly, everything is working great, and you can actually start working on your Zeal 8-bit computer right now. Okay, so that's it for this video. I hope it helped you. If you have any suggestion or if you're encountering any issue, feel free to leave a comment down below, and I will see you next time.